We are indeed very happy tonight to have Keith Shumate, the new head baseball coach at Lewisburg College, with us tonight to talk about catching and really to answer any questions that you might have. Keith came to Lewisburg from North Carolina A&T. He was there for 15 years as the head coach and did an outstanding job. I mean, over 300 victories in his 15 years there, a conference championship, a regular season championship, a tournament championship, and with a very limited budget and very limited resources there. So he's done an outstanding job in his coaching efforts. He played collegiately at Western Carolina when Jack Leggett, who is now the coach at Clemson University, was there. First baseman and designated hitter primarily, but has spent a lot of time with catchers and really has coached in just about every phase of baseball. Coached at Greensburg Grimsley on the high school level before going to A&T. So he is well-versed in the game of baseball, and I hope you'll ask a lot of questions. He's here to help you. We've already talked to him tonight about maybe coming back in the summer and doing a hands-on camp for a week. So we are tickled to death to have Coach Shumate with us tonight. And like I said, we'll go for about 45 minutes to an hour and it takes a little break, come back and wrap up. And anytime you have a question, just raise your hand. We stop and answer that and take care of that as we go along. So, Coach
Shumate, thank you very much. Appreciate being here. Thank you. Anytime we're going to talk about any part of baseball or anybody's going to talk, I'll be glad to be there. And thank you for coming out. I want to start out like this, okay? The season's on its right on top of us, okay? And somewhere in the next month or two, no matter what level of baseball, you're going to be getting ready to go to a practice or some type of workout or sign up. You know, I saw signs outside where February, I think the 7th, you're signing up. We have to get you ready to play. And I see players that are just beginning their careers, and I see players who are right in the middle of their careers, and I see a lot of parents. And I don't know if you know this, parents, but you've turned into your son's agents. You've turned into their coaches. You're their primary coach in a lot of cases. And you might say, no, you know, I'm just mom or dad. I'm not coaching my son that much. But you are coaching his confidence. And one thing I know about all the championship teams that I've been associated or been lucky enough to be associated with, they all had solid catching. And most of them didn't just have one catcher. They had at least two or three solid catchers. But show me a team that's a championship club that has a terrible catcher and you've got some kind of an imposter. It can't be done, okay? You have to have a solid catching crew. So we can take this anywhere you want to take it. I'm going to give you a presentation of what I'm looking for as a manager, okay, as a coach and a manager. In practice, I am a coach. I'm an instructor. But when it comes to the game, I am a manager. And I have to coordinate what the catcher does with everybody else, okay? Let's start out with how we're going to prepare ourselves as players. We need to prepare our players physically, mentally, and fundamentally. Now, that word fundamentally gets thrown around a lot of areas, okay? But I like to separate the physical, the mental, and the fundamental. So everything we talk about tonight, there will be a mental component and a physical component, all right? When we go to a baseball game, how is it that your child can be happy, the players can be happy, dad can be happy, and mom can be happy? It starts out with strikes, okay? And that's where we're going to start out tonight, okay? As a catcher, I want you to be involved in getting strikes, okay? And we tell all of our pitchers, you got to get what? You always tell them, get what? Get ahead. Get ahead. You guys, what does it mean to get ahead? Does anybody know? In the pitch leagues, and I know some of you are not in the leagues where they pitch. What is the pitcher? We want the pitcher to throw what? Strikes, okay? We'll give you some simple concepts, and we'll show you how to set up. To start out with, one of the biggest mistakes that our catchers make at all levels is they start out going from one side of the plate or the other side of the plate. For most of our amateur pitchers, and even for professional pitchers, we primarily need to be behind the plate to start with. It doesn't mean that we're giving in, but what we know is that most hitters are not ready to hit. We need to be able to throw a get-ahead fastball. If you're competing with another catcher for a job, your ability to get strikes might be why your manager or coach puts you in there. If I draw a line at the bottom of the strike zone, the very bottom, kneecap high, and I take the entire strike zone and I divide it into thirds, we definitely want to work at the bottom and below the zone most of the day. If I put my glove below the zone to make him throw low, and he throws too low, we have a ball. If I have the glove on the edge of the plate, and he doesn't hit it perfectly, we've got either a ball, or we've got a ball right in the middle of the plate that could get hurt. If I sit up outside, ball comes on 0-0 count, he misses a little bit, umpire misses it, the count is now 1-0. So what we do is instruct our catchers, there are going to be six or seven hitters where we are going to throw the baseball over the middle of the plate. If you drew a line on the bottom, we draw just a small triangle. Instead of giving a low target, we will put a higher target, slightly higher, above the knees. And we want our pitcher to get ahead. If he misses either way, up or down, we have a strike. Now we can expand the plate and go to the corners. Okay? Pitchers do not have to just throw four-seam fastballs. They can throw two-seam fastballs. So within the zone, this is a great time for a catcher to get his pitcher to throw two seams. Now, let's go to the physical part, and we'll come back to these pitches here and four seam, two seam. Physically, to catch, I have to be able to squat. The position that I want to sit in, my toes have to point out at least to the middle infielders, if not the corner guys. In the signal stance, behind the plate, I can be on my balls of my feet, I can be relaxed. Most of the times we're going to put the glove, the base of the glove here, to hide the signs. We're going to ask the catcher to pull his knees in. We want the right knee pointed at the second baseman. If we're sloppy here, the coach and the first baseman and the runners are going to be able to see what's going on. Base runners have evolved. They like to get at first base at all levels and peek in to the signals. They take a chance and peek in. We ask our first baseman at Lewisburg to make sure that he can't see our signs. If he can see the signs, then when a runner gets on, if we're throwing down a curveball sign and the runner sees it, he's going to be able to steal the bases. So we're going to give signals closed up. The arm needs to go right inside the fold here between the quad and the stomach. We don't want them too low. We don't want them too high. Right in the groin, okay? And we want to keep our chest up. If we're leaning over too much, we're going to hide the signs, okay? When we give these signals, we need to be deliberate. Deliberate meaning, one, not flash, okay? When your pitcher's out there huffing and puffing, he's not going to be able to see that. He's going to get mixed up, all right? At most levels of baseball, one's a fastball, two's a curve. You know, they'll have some similar, usually a three can be a slider or another pitch. A lot of time wiggles or change-ups. If we can, as base runners and coaches, tell what you're doing, we'll steal too many bases. In a few years, you're going to be at a level of play where they're going to steal bases. So you have to make sure that you don't give information away. Okay? Once we go from the signal stance into our regular stance, we balance ourselves And we usually go with about the same. You can go with either foot. At higher levels, you try to always move the same foot first, always, no matter which way you're going. I go to my spot. I'm nice and relaxed. Nobody's on base. I'm splitting the plate. The black of the plate is splitting my chest. Feet are pointed out. Parents, when you're setting your son up to catch, this setup, basically, if you put your right foot in the instep of your left foot and go out, the right side is set back just a little bit. That allows a little better balance and a little better getting ready to throw. Right now, nobody's on base. I'm comfortable. My feet are pointed out. And now I need to be in a comfortable position. If I'm not comfortable, if I'm falling back, if I can't squat, I'm not ready to catch. All right? When I give my target, this is important. I see a lot of targets with stiff arms. We tell all of our guys, take the meat next to the forearm, right here. We want you to start out nice and relaxed. Thumb is going to be at 2 o'clock. We'll allow it at 1 o'clock, but we like for it to be at 2 o'clock. We do not like pitchers who give targets like this. Can you see into my mitt? Can you see into my mitt? No. We like for the pitcher to be able to see at the mitt, whether it's slightly angled down or up. But physically, the chest is up, the feet are out, and we're relaxed. If the person's going to lean the arm forward at all, the elbow will clear the front knee. This is what we call the conventional way to catch. My heels are on the ground, the weight's on the inside of my feet, and I'm able here to relax in a relaxed way, catch pitches. Now, before we talk about how to catch them, everybody doesn't do things the same way. If we're going to allow the arm to go anywhere else, we will always allow the arm to go for the guy to pull the knee in, the young man or a young lady, and we'll let the elbow go outside if we have to. But we never want it to be inside. You see that sometimes. You'll even see it in the big leagues now and then with a catcher who's physically not ready to catch. He just can't do it any other way. He's too tight in the hips. The idea being, when I'm in this position, I can go for an outside pitch. I can go for the inside pitch. The pitch that causes the most trouble with catchers is when they get a fastball that's running in and you get this kind of action. The thumb gets hurt. They generally miss the baseball. A lot of catchers have to wear the protective cast here. What we tell them is there's a semicircle or a half moon on which they will move. They're able to move. The only way to catch this inside pitch consistently is to catch it in this area, in this manner. Okay? When we start to go thumb down, no good. Let's talk about some of the mental and fundamental parts of catching the baseball. I'm going to turn my back to you. You're the umpire, okay? I'll even stand up for part of this. If it's a right-handed hitter, let me have you come up, be a right-handed hitter real quick. I'm the catcher. You stand here as a right-handed hitter, okay? Very good, all right? Now, young man, you come here. You're going to be the umpire. I don't know if you know this, but this is where most umpires will set up. If I am the catcher, he's going to look over this shoulder. Go ahead and bear down, get down a little lower. The catcher is going to receive pitches a lot of times that are away, and the umpire is not going to be able to tell whether they are balls or strikes. Stay right there. Don't move. The umpire has to almost guess if you're not catching the ball properly. This is what I want you to know. Okay. When receiving these pitches, right, I want to be still. As soon as I move, he's going to say ball. Let's turn this around the other way. You're a right-handed hitter. Here's the umpire. Now you're the pitcher. All right? I'm setting up for a pitch. All right? When the ball is inside, he's going to be able to see the baseball. But when the ball is outside, he's really, if he doesn't have a good view, he's going to guess. The worst thing we can do is to catch this ball deep. The second worst thing we can do is move our body. That instinct tells him that, as an umpire, this is a ball. Framing. How many of you have heard of framing the baseball? Okay? How you receive the baseball is important, but there are a lot of myths about framing. Whenever I catch a baseball, I basically need to catch the baseball. Even though the baseball is in only a part of my glove, when I catch this ball, the umpire is looking to see if there's glove over the plate. If I try to jerk the ball in, I'm telling him that this probably was a ball. Too many people try to jerk the baseball. When if you catch the baseball, take a look. Catch the baseball. Is there glove over the plate? Is there? From your angle? He could possibly give me a strike on this ball just because I caught it out in front of my knees, not deep. But it is a myth and a fallacy that we are supposed to stick the baseball. And I'll tell you why. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. Whenever an umpire is umpiring a game, and the young men and women or young ladies are 10, 12 years old, they want to go home just like the 18-year-old game or the 24-year-old game. They are looking for strikes. They are looking for outs. That's what makes it a very good game. What really makes it tough on them is when they can't tell. And what they do is they look at the front elbow. One of the most important things you need to learn about catching the baseball is to try and catch as many baseballs with your elbow down. So if I can catch this ball with my elbow down, with very little trunk movement, I've got a better chance of a strike. I want to catch the baseball with the elbow down. Now, your high school coach may not do it that way. They may tell you to stick it. Well, we want you to stick it. There's a lane here. We want you to catch it in that lane. We do not want you to stick your arm out. That's hard, and you're going to see a lot of dropped balls. We do not want to see you stick it and rotate. That tells the better umpires you'll see in the playoffs that was a ball. That's going to be their instinct. So we like to see you slightly, if you catch a ball, just slightly funnel it towards the center of your body. After you catch it, funnel it just a little bit. If it's up here, just funnel it a little bit. The low ball, unless you have to block it, anytime you catch the ball under, the umpire says ball. We want to catch the baseball and always work it up towards the center of our chest. Ever so slightly, in a subtle way. Big movements, disrespectful to the game. Big movements, disrespectful. Are there umpires who will call it a strike when you jerk it into the zone? Yes. But as you move up the levels, that doesn't happen. Would you rather teach your child the right way or the wrong way? And that's what it boils down to. All right? Now, let's talk about where to set up in the box. I'm going to ask for volunteer again. You guys a little less shy now than everybody else. Come on up in the box. The box, from this corner of the plate here, there are 3 feet to the back line. So let's say this is the back line. Let's say he's as deep in the box as you can get. Get as deep back there as you can get. The rule is for me when I set up, I want to be able to reach out, and I want to be able to be almost touching with the glove. I want to be about no more than a foot's distance. If you are at least a foot from the back knee, you should be able to catch balls in your zone without the bat hitting you. You younger guys, if the bat hits the glove, then the batter is supposed to get the base, okay? Whatever hit he receives, he can have, but if you get him out, he automatically gets first base, okay? So we don't want catcher's interference. So no matter where he goes, I want to be able to reach out and be about a foot's distance, about another glove's distance. If I'm so close I can touch him, I mean, a guy with a long swing could hit me, and I don't want that. Now watch this. Not everybody at the lower levels stands in the back of the box. Even at the upper level, some guys work in the front of the box. Nothing upsets me more than at the end of the game when you're fixing the field, the catcher has been in one spot the entire day. There's a footprint here and one here. Two big holes. But we had batters hit in front of the box. Guys, what am I supposed to do if the batter moves up? What do? I move up with him, no doubt. So I'm going to move up and make that adjustment. Now my pitcher is going to have a better chance to throw strikes. This works when you're 12 years old. This works when you're 18 years old. Okay? All right. You go ahead and sit back down. Now, before we move on to blocking and throwing, receiving, there are some things that you can do and get away with. And people, your coaches will say, that's bad. That's bad. But you have to understand that at the higher levels, these are accepted practices. One is, when there's nobody on base, I can set up standard with my tail low, or it is okay. It is not lazy to be able to get down and give a lower target. It's not lazy. Lots of catchers in the big leagues will put one knee down. There are other catchers, and you don't have to focus on this at 12 years old, but there are other catchers in the big leagues and even a few in college, when they see a ball is going to be low, they'll keep the upper body still and they'll get a little more extension by dropping a knee. Nothing wrong with that. I just mention it so that if you watch TV and you get confused, nothing wrong with that whatsoever. Okay? Now, let's talk about the mental side. If I call a fastball, if you use the term stick it, your last thought in your mind should be that I want to stick it in my zone. The elbow is used as a shock absorber. This is no good. This is the opposite of sticking it, letting it drag us, letting it, you know, we call this butchering it, all right? We don't want to butcher it. We just want to receive it and firm it up. The elbow just bends a little bit towards the middle of our body. That's how we receive the baseball. If the last thing I do is call a curveball, any type of slider or breaking pitch, all right? Say you're in high school and you guys are throwing curveballs. My last thought has to be to block. It has to be to block. So rather than, let's say, fastball, okay, stick it. I give the breaking ball, it's going to be block, block, block. Now, how do we do that physically? We got it mentally, what we're supposed to do. Physically, and I'll show you again. Come on back up. I want you to turn sideways. The pitcher's right there. I want you to get in a low stance. Yeah, you're catching. All right, I'll let you hold the mitt so you can feel like a catcher. I want you to get in a low and relaxed stance to receive with nobody on base. Okay? The tail is low, almost on the heels. The feet are pointed out. He's on the inside of his feet. Okay? All right, now, there's a runner on base, or it's two strikes. Okay? If there are two strikes on the batter, he's got to make an adjustment. I want you to show me a stance where your tail is about 4 inches higher than that, where you're going to emphasize your quads, okay? These muscles, okay, good. Now, He's higher. Now he's in more of a position to block and to throw. Thank you. All right. Very good. Get some rest. Physically, we change. We get 4 inches higher. I'm going to use my quads. The back will be just a little bit flatter when I use my quads. When my tail is down, my chest is going to be a little bit more up. Okay? Let's talk about throwing the baseball and blocking the baseball. In the order that you should teach them, they're both important. Okay? Blocking will probably be, at the younger age, the more difficult one. Throwing has to be reinforced when they play catch every day. All right? So what we're going to do, we're going to go ahead, since we're in the stances, we're going to talk about blocking first. When we block, it's not any more difficult than this. Okay? The knees, if you drew some spots out in front of the knees simply are going to contact the floor. I'm not going to hit the floor hard right now, but I'm just going to go down. And early on, we'll let the glove lead. The glove will lead. I've read that the ball's going down. The bare hand goes between, okay? Instead of it being narrow, we want it to be wide. The feet have to kick out. Notice if the feet don't kick out, how high I'm sitting. But when the feet are out to start with, and they kick out, at this point, I'm able to block. Some people lean over the baseball. We don't necessarily lean over the baseball. We do put the chin down and in when we block the baseball. We try to see the ball right into our chest. A lot of catchers talk about blowing out and going relaxed. We let the ball hit us. Once it hits us, we have to get up and retrieve that baseball. And when we get up to retrieve that baseball, we need to retrieve it in a way that we can throw it to second base. Okay? When we pick that ball up, unless we have to bare hand it, we want to scoot over it with our feet lined up to throw. And we're going to use this part of our glove to scoop it into our hand. Okay? Now, how do we train our son, if he's just starting out baseball, to block? How? I'm going to show you a couple simple ways real quick. All right? Come on up here real quick. I know you're not 12 years old, but I want you to get back there and assume a catching stance. Okay? First of all, I want to show him the stance to get into. Go ahead and just ease down into a blocking stance, like you're blocking the baseball. Just go down. All right. Good. Now, feet are out. Go ahead and put a glove on. Very good. Okay, he's down. All right, the chin's down. Now, I want him to physically feel what it's like. So I'm going to take some balls, and I'm just going to throw them here and let him hit him in the chest. I'm going to emphasize that once you decide that this ball needs to be blocked, I want you to cut off ground. I want you to kill the hop. Parents, the thing that we don't want to see is the catcher trying to back up and block. You see that a lot of times where they are, the knees, coaches will say have the knees replace the feet. No. You want to, whenever possible, you want to gain on this baseball. If the baseball hits well in front of him, the closer he can get, the better. All right? We will go out, in front of him and just use a pointing drill. Go ahead and back up. We're just going to simulate, get into a stance to block. All right. Now, what will happen is I'm going to put down 3 balls. 1, 2, and 3. 3 balls. And all I'm going to do with a fungo or whatever is just point. Now, don't block because you don't have any shins on. But I'll go, boom, and he'll block that baseball. Okay. I'll go, boom, and he'll block that baseball. Whichever ball I point to, he goes down. And he gets back up. All right, you stand up. Okay, go ahead and relax a second. Take a break. I have to get him mentally ready, physically ready, and fundamentally ready. Whenever the baseball goes into the dirt and it's not straight in front of you, All you want to do from the blocking position is hook the outside shoulder, lead with the glove, and get it around the baseball. The idea being we want the baseball to always block back towards the plate. And people might say, well, why? What difference does it make? Well, first of all, it lines the baseball up for you to throw it to second base. But more than anything, the runner at first base, he is stifled by the fact that the ball is still in front of first place, or instead in front of home plate. Whenever the runner sees a ball that kicks off to the side, he automatically goes. Even the worst runners, they go. The slowest, the most passive, they go. Okay? So we want to put the ball back towards home plate. Okay? So what will happen is we'll just get out in front, and all we're going to do is start out nice and easy. You can use, if they're young, you can use some Incrediballs, soft, any kind of soft balls. And we're just going to underhand the ball wherever it goes. No more than three reps at a time and rest. Three and rest, three and rest, three and rest. The worst thing if you want to ruin a catcher is sit there and beat him to death. Okay? Do sets of two or three. If you take the pitching machine out there and you line it up and you're throwing missiles right there in front of him, he's not going to be a catcher for long. Okay? Because he's going to say to heck with blocking. All right? The next step, if I want to teach a young man how to block the baseball and get his confidence up, all right, I've got to teach it like the game. Biggest mistake is once the guy knows how to block is to sit there and let's say, take this mitt, all right, just sit there. The biggest mistake is to sit there and just throw balls into the dirt. Because what happens, he already knows that it's a block. What you want to do is you want to mix it with balls that are in the air. Balls in the air. Balls in the air. Balls on the ground. That's the way the game is played. Okay? More baseballs that are fastballs get through than breaking balls because they're quicker. They're not reading the down angle. There is zero excuse. Once they learn how to block the baseball, if they put the two, what is two? Breaking ball. Let's just say it's breaking ball. If they put a breaking ball sign down, they know it's a breaking ball. Mentally, what's their last thought? What should it be? Block. Now, if they don't have to block, they simply catch the baseball out front. But when they put down a fastball, they're thinking, stick it. If they're a poor blocker, you want to, and they're good at catching and receiving the baseball, you want to replace stick it with block it until they become a good blocker. Now, this is important. Mom, Dad, put this in your notes. This is the way the game's played. We'll get on to something more complicated in a second. Nobody on base. Do I have to block? Who says yes? Who says no? Anybody say yes? Anybody say no? Okay. Here's the deal. Put this in your notes. At all times, we want to keep the baseball off of the umpire. When you let the baseball hit the umpire, and it happens more than once, and the umpire starts to get hurt, he's going to get his somehow. They don't mean to, but subconsciously, they're not going to call strikes for you. Take care of them. You'd be surprised how many guys get to college, and when a ball does go back, and let's say it's fouled back and hits the umpire and hurts him, you'd be surprised how many guys will pick the ball up and throw it back to the pitcher and get ready to give the next sign. At this time, the catcher should call time, let the trainer or whoever check him, the other umpires, go out and talk to the pitcher. Give him time. Give the umpire time. Be nice to the umpire, okay? All you young guys, repeat after me. All you guys up here. All right? Repeat after me. Be nice to the umpire. All right. Don't forget that. Be nice to the umpire. Doesn't mean I agree with him. Okay? Never disrespect the game. Never say something bad to the umpire, even if you disagree with his calls. Okay? Until you get old enough to call him by his first name. Okay? And you guys aren't old enough yet. He is Sir, all right, or Mr. Ump. Mr. Ump. Okay? Put this in your notes, parents. Never call him Blue. Some of them have worked, and even the ones that haven't worked at higher levels, calling them Blue is disrespectful. We don't mean it that way, but Blue is the way they call a dog. Like, here, Blue. Here, Blue. We don't want to do that. All right? So be nice to the umpire. Okay? All right. Now, nobody on base. 0-0. Am I in a blocking stance? 0-0 count? No. What about 0-1 count? No. What about 0-2 count? There's nobody on base. Why am I blocking? Huh? That's right. If there is a strike, a swinging strike, if there's a miss, a lot of people don't know this, but if the ball even hits the ground, whether the umpire catches it or not, if it hits the ground, the batter is able to advance to first base and you have to put him out. You have to get him out. Okay? All right. We could go all day long about blocking. All right? At the higher levels for you high school guys getting ready to go to college, I'm going to give you the best drill ever. Find somebody who has a fungo. They don't have to hit the ball hard. You can get 40 feet away, 50 feet away, 60 feet away, 80, 90 feet away, and simply hit the baseball nice and easy in front of home plate. When you miss and the ball's in the air, they catch it in the air. When it's on the ground, I don't care if it bounces three times, they get practice of going down and blocking the baseball. Okay? Catcher asked me this one day, and I believe in telling you the truth. Now, the Little League coaches are going to shudder here. If you see that the ball is supposed to be blocked, you block it and you forget about catching it. Okay? Forget about it. But if a ball is thrown at the higher levels and the runner is stealing, all right, the guy asked me, is it okay to pick that ball? Fundamentally, we want him to think block, block, block. But at the college level and above, if he has practiced picking a ball when the runner is stealing, that is allowed at the big league level. But for us to be good, we have to work on block, block, block. Okay? Once you decide to block, you never try to what? Catch the baseball. You absorb the baseball. Let's talk about throwing real quick. When we play catch in the outfield, the catchers got to get their arms loose like everybody else. Some people have them doing drills, and they never really get a chance to get their arms loose. You know, they should use cords just like pitchers, get their arm warmed up, make sure their legs are loosened up, and play with four seams, okay? Four seams. You can do this at home. Just throw the ball up, and then just try to catch it and grab across seams. If you can get across seams, that is good. Four seams. Mom and dad is when 1, 2, 3, 4 are hitting the air. That's the straightest ball. Two seams is when I grab the baseball either with the seams, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 2 seams, or I can go across the two seams where they're narrow. 1, 2, only 1, 2 are hitting the air. And that's how the pitchers throw their sinkers. Now, when you throw, do you want the ball to sink or do you want the ball to carry? Do you want the ball to tail or do you want the ball to be true and straight? Which do you want? True and straight. If you want to be true and straight, try to get across the seams and try to be across four seams when you throw the baseball, okay? Here are some myths that we've got to knock out real quick. One is, when I don't have arm strength, All right, catching the baseball and trying to run the ball down to second base to throw is no good. At a young age, I'd rather you bounce it down there than to run with it. If you draw a line between the feet, and again, the right foot's going to be back just a little more to help the young man throw. I still want to be square up top, but the right foot's dropped back. When we receive the baseball, the ball is going to turn us. Number one mistake a catcher makes in throwing down to second base is that they try to do a lot of things. They start trying to move before the ball gets there, and they miss the ball. So all you young guys, and even you high school guys, I want you to repeat after me. Let the ball, say it again, let the ball turn me. Okay. I do not want to start turning my body or start trying to get a jump on the baseball. No matter what anybody tells you, you have to catch the ball first. The only movement that we would ever allow is this movement. Before the ball actually goes into my glove, the right knee can turn in. The right knee is allowed to turn in just to get the athlete on the inside of that foot. It's allowed to turn in. Okay? That can help a lot of athletes. Next myth. Or I sort of mentioned it before, but here it goes again. When I get ready to throw, the less that I travel, the quicker I'll get the baseball down. If I draw an X right below my chin, when I'm done, I would like for my right foot to be on that X. The further in front of that X I go, all right, the less I really believe in my arm. Believe in the arm that you have. Let the ball turn you. Make the exchange always in the center of the body. How many of you have heard a coach tell you, take the ball to the ear? Have you heard that before? It wasn't wrong, but what happens is gloves have changed over the years. It used to be, in the days of Yogi Berra and other great catchers, they caught the ball with two hands. If you're teaching two hands, the way you teach it is you put the thumb inside the hand and the hand goes right behind the glove. And that way it's protected. We don't teach that so much at the college level. You don't see that. We take the hand, and what happens is when we get ready to go butt up, our hand stays either in here or we prefer right outside the quad, here. A guy came along named Johnny Bench, and Johnny Bench started one-hand catching, okay? Goes down today as the greatest catcher of our time. You know, we might can argue in some areas, but what Johnny Bench did was he caught the ball. You see, our mitts changed. Just like our outfielders now catch the ball, they don't have to catch the ball two hands. We want them, when they catch a ground ball in front of them, to use two hands. We want them, when a ball's in front of us as an infielder, to use two hands. A ground ball, two hands. But when we're on the run in the outfield, one hand is balance. If an infielder runs after a baseball and he has to reach for it, he needs to use one hand. Two hands will cause him to miss the baseball. So you have to differentiate. In one hand catching, the other hand's going to be there. But we're going to make the exchange, not up here where we can't get a grip. We're going to make the exchange immediately in the middle of the body as I turn. In the middle of the body, you're going to have a true gripping of the baseball. The athlete's going to be able to get four seams on the ball. A lot of guys, this is what you want to look for with your older guys and your younger ones, is receiving it and flipping it. We do not want to flip it. That's not going to be consistent. Some people might want you to flip it. I'm here to tell you, all right? Division I, junior college, professional baseball. We don't flip the baseball, all right? We get a good exchange. We take the glove and press the ball into the hand, okay? When we throw, if I'm going to move this, I'll tell you what, I'll use this line here. Whenever I throw, whatever my center line is, that's the line that I want my foot, my right foot to be on. So when I get ready to catch the ball and throw, I want to make sure that my right foot is on that line. The right foot is going to travel somewhere between 5 to 6 inches, and for a younger guy, it might be as much as a foot, maybe a foot and a half. But the less or the least amount is best. Less is best, okay? There are variations, okay? Now, I'm going to blow your mind again here. Most catchers cannot throw well to second base, not because of their arm strength, but because they do not get closed off. They're in such a hurry, they come up and they try to throw, and the shoulder is still 6 to 12 inches open. So if I'm throwing to you guys here in front of me, I want to make sure when I exchange that I get my shoulder closed. Same thing, my shoulder closed. Same thing here, my shoulder is closed. But parents, coaches, agents, all right? That's what you are, you're agents right now, okay? You're trying to find the best situation for your son or your daughter. The lower half does not have to be all the way closed. Take a look. Most of the best catchers in the big leagues, when they're done, they are closed, but their left foot is slightly open of the line. It might be closed angle, but it's not blocking them off. The other thing we look for is when they throw, we want them to throw with their back foot down. It's important when they throw to let the back laces go down. Keep that foot down for power. You don't want the foot to fly up in the air early. You want to keep the back foot down. Turn the laces down. Next, when I throw the baseball, I don't want to throw the baseball to the base. You guys, again, repeat with me. Repeat, all you young players, older too. Repeat. Over the base, at the waist. Over the base, at the waist. Okay? Now, your coach is going to praise you. If this is second base and you throw down and the ball goes right here perfect, you are going to be praised. They're going to be like, yes! That's good. Okay? If the throw is really high and goes in the outfield, not so much praise, okay? All right? But if you aim for this low spot, more times than not, the ball's going to hit the ground. That's still okay-ish, but what happens when the ball hits the ground? It slows down. And it causes the infielder to have to reach for the baseball. And sometimes it goes all the way through anyway, and that's not good. That's not good, okay? So, throw the baseball to the waist. The weaker the arm, let's say your strength has not come in yet. It may not come in until you're 18, 19 years old. Some guys are strong when they're 15, 16. They can make that throw. Then you can aim a little bit higher. You can throw a little more to the face. But I'm telling you, when you move up the ladder and you make the high school team and you got a chance to go play college and you want to get in the starting lineup in college, throw the ball to the waist. And if it misses low, you're perfect. Now, when you really get good, maybe you can go to the knee. All right. By the way, this is a team game. If you throw the baseball down to a second baseman or shortstop and they're not there, that's bad. All right, You got to go have a talk with them. Coaches got to have a talk with them. They've got to see if the runner's going. Make sure that they don't get the ball hit and run on them. Get to the base on time. We have our infielders go to the front, and we have them straddle if it's a good throw. And we have them wait for the ball. Don't let your shortstop get to the front of the base, which is lazy, and not move on a good throw, and then reach for the ball. The ball that you throw is a lot faster than the one that they try to swipe. Now, I'm going to teach the shortstop and second baseman how to tag. And I want you to remember this as a catcher. When they tag the runner out, if it's a good throw, it's and sell it to the umpire ready to throw it around. You'd be surprised when you tag at home, first, second, or third. When you quick tag and show it to the umpire, it brings a response, okay? It's like, I expect something. I expect an out, all right? Not only do I show you I caught it, which wasn't even an issue. I caught it anyway. It was in the air. It was an easy catch. But I show you I got the ball, and I'm ready to throw it around. If they make the wrong call, do we say anything to the umpire? No. Always what? Be nice to the umpire. What do we call the umpire? Sir or Mr. Ump? Okay, Mr. Ump. All right. Throwing. All right. Do we always throw to second base? No. Sometimes we throw to third base. All right. Right-handed batter. Come on up, instructor. Assistant. Shorter is better. Here are my rules for a young catcher. When I receive the baseball and a runner's going to third, I let the ball what? Turn me. I let the ball move me. I catch the ball, and I want to stay as short and quick as possible. If I have an open throwing lane, then all I do is just throw. If he's deep and I have to do just a little bit of a drop, I keep it short. For us at Lewisburg, we never throw over the batter. Never. Okay? Never. 90% of our throws are behind the right-handed hitter. The rule book says the hitter must remain where he's at. He cannot drift back into you. Sometimes they want to get out of the way, and they'll move right back into you. That's interference. If, let's say that no matter where I'm throwing, if the guy gets in front of me, all I have to do is lean over the plate when I throw here. Ready? Lean over the plate. All I have to do is make contact with him, and we've got interference. Okay? If it happens. All right? Now and then, you're going to get a pitch when you're sitting outside. You're going to get a pitch that's somewhere way up here. If you get that situation, then it is okay to throw in front of the hitter when you're throwing to third base. Most important rule, let the ball move you. Let the ball turn you. Okay? All right. Be a left-handed hitter. This is advanced. This is a little more for the high school guys. Whenever we set up inside on a righty, we set up inside. We're in the middle, we're in the middle. But when it's a left-handed hitter, and there's a runner that wants to steal, we're going to give our target inside, off of center. We are not going to get totally behind the left-handed hitter. Does anybody know why? Any idea? Blurt it out. I think you're on the right track here. Most catchers, when they catch this ball, what's the first thing they're going to do? They're going to go this way, okay? When we first started talking about throwing, we talked about this line. You never want to clear that line with your right foot. That time is going to allow the runner to steal the base, okay? You're good. So never totally behind the left-handed hitter when there's a guy on base. Just a little small thing. Other things about your setup that affect the running game. Doesn't even have anything to do about throwing, but watch this. Somebody tell me what pitch is coming here. I'm not going to let you see. All right? Tell me what pitch is coming. He says fastball. Tell me what pitch is coming now. I'm covering my sign up. Breaking ball. As catchers, we want to go into our stance the same way every time. If you have to hop on the breaking ball, hop on the fastball. Okay? The umpire would rather you be smooth. But I don't know how many high school games we go to, and the catcher will get in this alert position, butt high when he calls a curveball. Okay? Here's another one. Catcher gives a sign, okay, whatever sign it is. And then he just simply goes sideways and settles down. But then all of a sudden, he gives a sign. And instead of hopping, he moves up. And he lets the whole world see it. When you move up, you've told the other team that the breaking ball's coming, okay? So you set up where you can catch all of the pitches. All of the pitches, okay? We had a team at A&T one year. We didn't have the resources, but we stole 150 bases. We finished second in the nation in stolen bases to a team called Miami, okay? And one of the ways we did it is we watched catchers. And we had a saying, okay? If the catcher goes wide, I'm gone. Whenever the catcher gets really wide, he's thinking about blocking, okay? So be consistent back there, all right? How much time we got here? We good? Yes. The next part will be questions, but we've got so much other we could talk about. We won't make it long, but I just want to whet your appetite with this. Let's talk about the mental part of running the game, okay? And what a catcher needs to do responsibility-wise on his other plays and to get the pitcher where he needs to, okay? Thank you for your attention. Let's take a good break here. All right. Thanks. Thank you. Hey, I just want to hit some high spots real quick. And if they apply to you in the league you play in, great. If not, we'll help the older guys with it just a little bit. Let's talk about the glove real quick. Sometimes the gloves are too small and narrow. The baseball wants to see in it. The bigger the target, the better. When these get too loose, you can tighten them up, but they can get too tight. The spot that you want to catch is right here between the fingers. That's the spot that you want to catch. A lot of people think that you catch the ball way up in the top. That's only in an emergency that happens. You want the mitt to be broken in enough that the ball closes the mitt. We don't really do the tweezers thing. The ball should close the mitt. We work for the pitchers. They are the reason for our existence. And you may not believe that. You may believe this is about you getting drafted, you getting to the summer league team and being the number one guy. But we have to work for the pitcher. I guarantee you, your manager, your head coach, your instructor will be happier if you have the lowest earned run average than if you have the high batting average. Your dad's going to be proud of that batting average. Mom's going to love it that you're playing. But your coach wants you to run the pitching staff. This is for parents, coaches, and everybody. I'm going to give you some suggestions about how to act and call a game and that sort of thing. First of all, everybody's looking at me. I want to have positive body language. If a ball ever gets through, I go after it. I'm never going to sit up there and go, you know, or slam my glove. I'm not going to turn around and question the umpire. I'm looking straight ahead, and all I care about is the next pitch. All I care about is the next pitch. My pitchers, all right, are all that matter. And guess what? For Tommy, I might have to set up a little more outside than usual. If Johnny is pitching and Johnny keeps running the ball over here, I may have to give the target way out here just to get this. In general, when the count's 0-0, 1-0, 2-0, 2-1. These type of counts, unless it's a special hitter, we probably need to get our pitcher to throw over the plate. We need to sit behind the plate. But when we get ahead in the count, and especially if we have a pitcher who can locate, there are not many of those guys. But when you have them, you're going to get to sit up outside more. We definitely want to expand the plate. If you play, how many of your sons play on a team, parents or kids, raise your hand, where the coach calls the pitches? Raise your hand. I'm not here in judgment of that, okay? I think that's fine. Somebody has to show the young man how to call pitches, okay? Couple of things. You got a young man who throws the curveball at a young age, maybe younger than he should be throwing it. But somebody's shown him how to throw it and throw it properly. When we got a guy like that, we still need to develop his fastball. We will strike out more people if we will hide the breaking ball. Don't show it until somewhere along the 0-2, 1-2 area. When we get in love with our breaking balls, the hitters see them, and late in the game, they're not as bothered by them. Also, most curveballs and sliders, I don't know if you know this, are designed to be balls. So you're actually throwing a ball that is not going to be a strike as often. If you're teaching your guy to throw a lot of curveballs for called strikes, what you're doing is you're teaching him. You may win today, you might win a little tomorrow, but you're teaching him to throw his curveball as a hung curveball. Let's face it, you have to control the spin and throw it a little higher to get it to be a strike. While popular at the 12, 13, 14-year-old area, we don't want hung breaking balls, okay? And if we do throw a high breaking ball off of our fastball, we want the bottom to fall out, all right? Here are just some small things that will help out. Let's say that your pitcher is struggling and he keeps throwing the ball high. All you have to do is just, with nobody on base or whatever, is when you call the breaking ball, just, you know, without the hitter seeing it, you know, put the ball in the dirt. Every now and then you can do something without the hitter seeing it to let him know to get the ball in the dirt. Pitchers, I'm going to tell you all how to be pitching coaches as catchers. The most important part in throwing strikes is getting your pitcher to keep his face flush, squared up to the target. To help with that, if you can get your pitcher to keep his chin and drive his chin to the target, he's going to throw strikes. Because look, when the chin goes this way, he's not going to throw strikes. Even if the rest of his mechanics are perfect, if he's got a big head jerk, he's not going to throw strikes. To help that, we have to decide to give our targets early. Sometimes in college baseball, they worry a little bit too much, especially at Division I, about somebody relaying location. So they'll wait until the last second and get to a spot. Sometimes there are some pro teams that will wait late. But most of your championship clubs, once a pitcher has started his movement with his foot and his rocker step, they go ahead and get to the spot. I believe you should get to the spot as early as you can, even before that. I want the other team to tell them where the ball's at. We can cross them up. I want them to swing the bat. When you play winning baseball, you've got the other team swinging the bat. When you're playing losing baseball, the other team is taking a lot of pitches because you're not throwing a lot of strikes. The next thing is the trips to the mound. Trips to the mound need to have a purpose. Our goal is to never take a trip to the mound. The umpire's happy. And if the umpire's happy, everybody's happy. But if the umpire gets ticked at us, it's bad. When we go to the mound, we go to the mound with instructions from the coach or whatever, or when there's a meeting, We try to make most of our pitching changes in between innings. We want to limit how many times we go out there and stall and then get a guy ready to come in. You see that at the World Series level. You see it pro ball, but in general, the umpires don't like that. So get your pitchers warmed up. The best thing you can do for your starter is go warm him up in the pen. As a coach, a lot of times, or parents, we're coaching, we'll have one catcher go warm the pitcher up. But then we'll have him come in and throw to another catcher. The starter should warm up at least part of the time with his catcher. All right. Even the Mike Piazzas and the Pudges and all those guys, they even got in the habits later in their career, they would go down and actually catch a few of the pitches. You could go to Atlanta and see McCann. He would go down and warm up his starter. They do have bullpen catchers, but the starter is going to get the game going, okay? And you need to have a relationship with him, all right? There are other things. It may be that he goes too slow. The pitchers go too slow. And then at the end, there's a jerk. They take pitching lessons, and the pitching coach has them, okay, we're going to go nice and slow and get their form right. But they never get into speed. They never have a tempo. As a catcher, we can remind the guy, hey, full tempo, all right? The ball down, all right? If he misses high, quit giving this target. At Lewisburg, we give this target to get ahead. But once we start throwing our sinkers, we give the targets much lower, much, much lower, all right? A couple of other things. When the guy does something good, let him know he does it good. If you're in a league that throws the ball around, all right, throw the ball around, hit the guy in the chest, all right? There's nothing more demoralizing when a guy comes up and throws a ball in the left field because he doesn't like to throw. Practice that. Practice it. Tag plays. It's amazing that how many times we will throw a ball home, we miss the cutoff man, and we got to play, and everybody's excited, but we haven't taught our catcher how to make this play. The catchers need to take ground balls. At Lewisburg, when our catchers don't have anything else to do, we send them into the infield when we're hitting a lot of ground balls. They go out with their mask on and their equipment, and they'll sit there and we'll hit them ground balls, and they'll turn and catch those balls and tag the guy out. Or sometimes they're one-hand tags, and they show it to the umpire. But they have to learn how to field ground balls. Biggest mistake that they make is fielding from up to down. How should they field?
Down.
They should field from down to up. There's an art of the catcher acting like nothing's going on and then being able to make the play. If the catcher is going to deke the guy, he'll give him the plate, and then all of a sudden he'll move to a point right in front of the point of the plate, this point here. I don't like for the catchers to get right against the edge, about 5 inches. If you're not into fooling them or deking them, you always want to show them plate. You guys can see plate, can't you? If I'm standing in front of the plate, no matter what the rules say in your league, what's likely to happen here? There's more of a chance that the runner, even though he knows he's supposed to slide, he feels challenged. He doesn't see you with the ball. He's liable to run through you and there be a collision. We want the guy to slide. That's what the league rules say. Encourage him to slide by showing him some plate. Okay? Guys, it is okay to let them catch the baseball and then to tag with a swipe tag. If we haven't taught them how to get down and block the plate, we need to let them tag that way. Buster Posey tags that way a lot now. A lot of catchers have gone to that because it's not worth tearing up their career. If and when there is collision, the toe needs to be pointed at third base. No matter how they start out, when they step in, they're not going to get hurt as bad if someone slides into the knee. But if the knee is sideways and there's some kind of collision, that's when we have a year-ending hopefully not, but maybe a career-ending type injury, one that's going to put us out a year or two and slow our progress down. Okay. Be nice to the umpire. Get confidence in the pitcher. Don't let your pitcher worry about the last pitch. Don't let him worry about next inning when he's got to face that big bruising hitter. All we care about is the next pitch. You know, give him, everybody calls it now glove love. You know, you catch the ball, he throws a good pitch. Yeah, you know, take that glove and give him a little love. If you're going to work on first and third plays, do you guys do first and third plays? Okay, do you? You may not do that as much when you're younger. We have a real simple play. We throw the ball down to second base, okay? At the higher levels, you catch the baseball. As we get ready to throw, we will glance the runner. If the runner has his shoulders squared, then we just abort the play and we'll throw to third. Unless they're running a play, we're going to come up and we're going to glance and we're going to throw the baseball down. For whatever reason, that runner does not run as fast when there's a runner on third. Also, don't think that just because there are runners on first and second that you have to throw to third base every time. Let me give you a little quiz. Where would you throw the baseball? If the runners took off stealing, okay, and the runner on third was the fastest, I mean on second was the fastest man in the world, and the runner on first was the slowest man in the world, and they both took off stealing, where would you throw the ball? Second base. See, we figure this out. The guy on first, a lot of times, even when he's fast, he doesn't want to take off until he's sure that other runner's going, okay? And this is an age where guys don't hustle. So you can throw the balls to other places. A couple more errors and we'll shut it down. Let's talk about pop-ups. Pop-ups. Remember what I told you. Two hands is sometimes good. But everybody put your hands above your nose. Even moms, put your hands above your nose. How in the world are you going to see the baseball right there? And then we get mad when they drop a pop-up. The area to catch a pop-up is as high is up high enough, not low, but off of the shoulder that the glove is on. Okay? When the ball goes up, let's say that it's a right-hand or left-handed hitter, and I don't know where the ball is, which way should I turn first? Anybody know? Always turn opposite of the hitter. Next, I'm going to find the baseball. All right? There's some other steps in here. If you use the old mask, okay, and you take the mask off and find the baseball, you're going to run to the fielding area and throw the mask in the opposite direction. The back is always going to be turned to the mound. If it's on this side, the back is going to be turned to the mound because the ball spins back towards the field. All right. Roy Campanella, great catcher for the Dodgers. He used to talk about this in spring training, and he would say, remember that the ball goes up one chute, all right, but it comes down another one, meaning that a lot of catchers, young catchers, will run all the way to the wall, and they saw the chute, it went up. But it always comes down going back towards the field. So I want to keep the baseball in front of me and let it work back towards me, okay, when I catch the pop-up off of the left shoulder, okay? Here's one that really gets me. How many of your catchers have the hockey mask? Honestly. That's the best mask now. It's not old school. You know, we like the two-piece. You know, it's real sexy. You know, that's the one. And that's good. That's fine. A lot of people can see better with that. But if you use the hockey mask, I see it at every high school game I go to. The hockey mask is meant for you to keep it on. Always, no matter what mask they use, if there's a collision at the plate, keep the mask on. Do not throw it off. That's your armor. Learn to catch the ball with it. On the pop-up with the hockey mask, leave the hockey mask on, okay? Leave it on, all right? Learn to catch it. That's why it was designed, so you could leave it on, okay? All right. At our level, there's bunts. There is communicating with pickoffs. A lot of other things with catching. I'll make myself available as long as you need me tonight. I know it's been a long night for some of you. But if we can teach them to catch the baseball, if we can teach them to block the baseball, and we can get them to throw the baseball, all right, we can talk about mechanics and where it should be. But if we can focus on those three skills, the game will help teach them the others. Talk to guys who caught. I've talked to lots of guys who caught. You know, we live in an age of video, YouTube. Look up the great catchers, not just today's catchers. You can see Johnny Bench today on YouTube, and it's amazing. He did not take his glove to right here. The exchange was in the ribs, okay? It was natural, and we need to make catching natural. The last thing I'll say today, catching is the hardest thing to find in the game today. Pitching's still the most important, but catching is the hardest thing. If your son wants to be a catcher, give him a chance. At the age of about 13 or 14, if the arm strength is not there, and you think he needs to play at the highest levels, and you think he has a chance to play at high levels, it's okay for him to change positions. At the age of 17 and 18, if you can't throw the baseball, you're really hurting him if he's going to try to play at the next level. If he can be a good high school catcher receiving and practice at another position, that would be ideal. Okay? I'm going to stop. I could go on all night. Nobody knows it all about catching. But from a manager's standpoint, catch the baseball, set up in the right place. Let's get strikes, and then let's expand. Let's be confident. Let's have great body language. Let's be positive. And when we get in the cars, Mom and Dad, let's celebrate whatever happened. Let's not talk about individual performance. Let's talk about the team. Let the coaches or even yourself instruct them the next day after a cooling down period, okay? Never talk about 0 for 4, 4 for 4. Always celebrate the team, okay? Thank you very much. Appreciate you. Questions, I guess.
Yeah, you might have a question.
Questions, anything? If you want to stay around individually, that'll be fine too. Okay.